Ooh, ee, ooh, ah, ah, ting tang, walla walla bing bang. Yep, that's me ready to go.
Hello and welcome to the Movie Chef podcast, where we make a meal out of movies. I'm your host, Chef Tebbs, and every episode we'll be bringing you a fantastic recipe of movies, films, cinema, and whatever the hell else you want to call it. With me today is the leader of the Cormaniacs. It is Cormac. Welcome, Cormac.
Hello.
You can't see it, but he's flicking me the V's over the camera here. I think it's absolutely disgusting of a podcast.
It's disgusting, especially when I do this.
Excuse me, I'm going to have to. I've got to go tick the explicit button now. We are the Movie Chefs, and every episode, like I said, we're going to be bringing you lots of insight into our weird and wonderful world of how we look at movies, how we look at Hollywood, and try and cook up some entertainment for you to while away these cold, lonely days. First off, we're going to have a look at some of the movie news. You've been keeping up? You've been looking at the news this week?
Yes, I've been seeing a few things. Seen a few things about a Mad Max prequel.
Yeah, apparently there's a prequel being made to Mad Max Fury Road called Furiosa.
Okay.
It was supposed to be, well, obviously the role played by Charlize Theron in the 2015 film Mad Max Fury Road, but apparently this time they were looking at de-aging, they were looking at doing the old Ant-Man Avengers technique and try and make Charlize Theron look younger, but instead I think they're going
bollocks.
Okay, let's wait. This is bullshit.
There's only one woman who they should be looking at.
Go on.
Would you like to hear her name? It's Kirsten Stewart.
Okay, well, thanks for tuning in, everybody. This has been the Movie Show
Podcast. Fuck you!
Kirsten Stewart. Why? Kirsten Stewart. Whatever her name is.
Is it Kirsten or Kristen?
Are we talking about the mouth breather from Twilight?
I don't think you can say that, Paul.
She just stands there with a gob open all the time. So yeah, she's breathing out.
Oh, right, okay. I thought that meant something completely different there. Sorry.
Well, go check your urban dictionary. I'm quickly finding through it.
I am not urban in any way.
I can tell that. Twilight Stewart. Why her?
I think she is physically fit. I think that she already looks like a post-apocalyptic person. I don't know. I just think she's got that kind of look. You know, she's been in that. Yeah, okay. She was in that Charlie's Angels movie that was panned. I never seen it, but you know what? It's probably one of those movies that I would actually enjoy. But I think she's got that whole kind of, you know, ballsy kind of, you know, short hair kind of action type girl.
You can see her as an action star as opposed to just a leading lady or whatever. So you can see her fitting right into that. Apparently it's a lass called Anya Taylor-Joy who they've been having conversations with. She was in, let me have a look. She's in a load of crap horror films. She was in Split. As one of the friends in Split.
Is that the Shyamalan movie?
Yeah, the Unbreakable sequel that wasn't, but it was. Apparently she's been in Peaky Blinders as well, so apparently they're looking at her at playing
What an awful trilogy as well. But let's just break that down. What an awful, awful trilogy. Unbreakable was an awful movie. How that ever got a sequel? How the fuck did that happen?
I'll be honest, I've gone through my entire life watching everybody comment about Unbreakable being amazing and wonderful and this subversive superhero film. It was shite.
It was crap.
Yeah. But Anya Taylor-Joy, she's lined up for the Furious. I'm going back on this. I enjoyed Split. But that was more of a Xavier. What's he called? Scottish guy. That was his film. McAvoy. James McAvoy. Have you seen Split and Glass?
Genuinely, no. I've seen Unbreakable. It's like I don't know. I didn't enjoy Unbreakable. I thought it was so mundane. You know, it was just lots of slow tracking shots, and you know, everybody looking at Bruce Willis like he's and then Bruce Willis standing in the rain.
Bruce is really quiet and subdued, and looks like he didn't want to be there. Such a method performance. And then you watch every
and then you watch every
film after the year 2000, and it's just the exact same. Split, I thought, was good. That's James McAvoy film. Watch it, as it's not a sequel to Unbreakable. Just watch it for a film. He's great in it. Glass was just a big disappointment. But yeah, Anya Taylor-Joy, she's in that. She's also in New Mutants. I think the reason it's called New Mutants is because it was supposed to come out before X-Men in the year 2000, but it's been delayed that much. It was originally filmed in 2017, late 2016, nearly 2017. And this New Mutants, the last of the 20th Century Fox X-Men franchise films, has been given another new release date of August 28th. Do you care about this? Are you bothered?
I don't know. The last kind of run of X-Men movies, it started off, I thought they went in the right way, you know, the first class kind of stuff, introducing new mutants, you know, maybe staying away from the older types, and then they just kind of, I don't know where the fuck they went, like, your woman Sophie Turner, what's her name, Sophie Turner, is her name?
Yeah.
You know, they just seen it as a vehicle for her, and again, you can see it straight away in some private little room in Hollywood. This is your vehicle, you know, blah blah blah. You know, the last movie was just so awful.
I enjoy comic book films. I enjoy watching them. I've never read comics back cover to cover. I just love the stories of them. But I do know, if you're gonna make a Dark Phoenix film, you need a strong performer, and those X-Men prequels were first class for me. I enjoyed it. It was all right. It was different. It wasn't Wolverine focused for once, which I enjoyed. And then the next three were just shat the bed. But this one was supposed to come out around the same time as Dark Phoenix. Apparently the director on New Mutants, Josh Boone, did the film. And then they went back and did test screenings and said, this is absolute garbage, go and do it again. So he went and refilmed it as less of a horror-focused film, more of a sort of a kid's tweeny action, you know, very light, much lighter. And then when Fox got sold to Disney, they've gone back and said, just make it how you want, Josh, who gives a shit? So I think we're going to be getting this PG-13 horror of mutants in an insane asylum. But to be honest, if this film comes out on August 28th, I'm not going to say I'm going to eat my hat, because it probably will do then, but I can't see it coming out on August 28th. I can't see anybody coming out, especially right about now. But
is this the whole premise of it? Is it mutants in an insane asylum? Is this what it is? Or
It was set, I don't even know when it's set, to be honest. I think that's one of the things that they were supposed to be doing reshoots on them, when there were a lot of theory that it was supposed to go into the MCU, and they were doing the reshoots to help it fit with the MCU, and this was the X-Men being introduced into this new universe. But then apparently they've gone back and Disney has said, we don't want anything to do with it. I don't know, there's a lot of rumour, but it's basically just five young mutants, all sort of teenagers, early 20s. They're all getting to grips with their abilities, and they're in some kind of facility, asylum, hospital. We've got in this? We've got Maisie Williams from Game of Thrones.
Yeah.
Anya Taylor-Joy. We've got Charlie Heaton, who is...
Oh, yeah, that kid from Stranger Things.
Yeah, the charisma. He's in that. We've got Blue Hunt.
Listen, he may not have a lot of charisma, but he's got some smouldering eyes.
He's smouldering good looks. Hey, look, they can get you a lot. They can get you far. They can get you into a mutant film. And then a bunch of other people I don't recognise. So I don't think there was a lot spent on this, but after reshoots and stuff. Anyway, look, I'm not bothered for this. I much prefer them to take the film and re-put it in, you know, make something into the MCU and just draw a line under it. But... apparently one of the reasons why they were supposed to be putting it out into the cinema is because they don't want there's a video on demand contract in place for it to go to one certain supplier and not another, and Disney want it on their platform. So it's a bit of a mess. It's a bit of a leftover, and I think right now they just need to put it out, leave it, send it out to die and forget about it and move on. But we'll see come August 28th. Future movies. We've had The Matrix 4, which started filming in February and has got, obviously been put on hold as to everything that's going on. They're looking at an early July filming to start up again. Are you excited for this?
I've not really read that much about Matrix 4. I recently rewatched all three of the Matrixes. We watched the first one and my son actually liked it. So we decided, you know what, fuck it, we'll watch the three of them, we'll see what he thinks. About halfway through the second movie, he was just bamboozled, just completely and utterly confused as to what was going on. So I'm just trying to figure out if it's going to go down that kind of vein, whether they're just going to throw all this mythology crap back in it, or are they just going to stick to the basics, or is it a remake, or what is it?
It is. It's one of these that is a sequel slash reboot slash whatever you want to call it. Carrie Ann Moss and Keanu Reeves are back.
Okay.
Lana Wachowski is directing this. She will be doing it on her, directing this one on her own without her sibling. With the return of Carrie Ann Moss and Keanu Reeves, I don't mean to spoil it for your boy, but I think we know what happened at the end of Matrix 3.
Yeah, and I'm even more confused than ever. So is it going to be a reimagining of it?
Well, I've read rumours, and again, these are rumours online, take from it what you will. This film is still being shot. It's had about 2 months of filming, so take, you know, I don't doubt much of it is in the can anyway. The general gist of what I'm hearing is we're going to have a young Morpheus. I don't think we're going to have de-aging. I think we're all right. I think there's another actor who's coming in for that. I can't remember which one it is. Sorry, I do apologise to everyone who's relying on me for their Morpheus news.
you slack bastard.
You prick. The fucking download numbers are just going to tank on this one.
What?
I didn't know anywhere
I'm
else.
There for some Lawrence Fishburne news.
The one thing that is floating around is that The Matrix is obviously a digital creation, and people's appearance in the Matrix is a digital a virtual representation of their digital self. Whether that
what
digital
self,
fucking
cop out. What a
that
fucking
was in,
cop out.
That was in the first film. That was a
no,
line from
I,
the first
I,
film.
No, I get that. I understand that. But what I mean is, it's a fucking movie cop out, isn't it?
Completely.
It's like we were talking last week about, you know, in Hudson Hawk, where Hawk falls through the canopy and already is in the seat, you know, so they're just going to try and pull the wool over everybody's eyes and, you know, some young kid's going to pop out with Keanu Reeves' accent. Yeah. Whatever.
Well, I think there's also another rumour that Keanu Reeves could be either a superhero who lives within the Matrix. So in The Matrix, there is this superhero Neo that flies around. Or there's another rumor that he could now be the digital representation of an agent. And he is the one that the humans have to fight now, which I think would take a steaming shit on the first three films, to be honest.
It's just basically going to work as if the first three movies didn't happen. That's what this is going to be, isn't it?
I hope not. But on that same theme, though, we've got a Scarface remake, reboot, whatever you want to call it, mm-hmm. That's been announced. Michael B. Jordan is being lined up for the main role, being awesome. Directed by Luca Guadagnino. 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 A guy called Luca is directing it. He was the one who directed Call Me By Your Name. The awards touted film. No, believe it. But yeah, Michael B. Jordan coming in as Tony Montana. There's two things that I want to say here. First of all, do you want this? Do you want to see it? Do you think it'll be good with Michael B. Jordan? Do you think he would pass off as a Cuban?
Cuban?
Or do you think Or do you think they're gonna, or do you think they're gonna reframe it for some other country? And secondly, well, what do you think this does to the? Let's go with that one first. Do you want this?
Well, you know, let's just get into not. Well, I suppose not get into the debate about whether Hollywood's run out of ideas and things like that. There.
Let's start with that. A Scarface remake set in modern times with Michael B. Jordan. Do you want to see that?
No,
no, me neither. No disrespect to Michael B. Jordan, but
the best thing about Black Panther.
Oh yeah, definitely. Yeah, But in terms of making this film, though, then there's a lot of people, and I've had conversations with people online about this. Does a reboot, good or bad, constitute an excuse, a reason for diminishing the impact of the first film? So if you see a really shite Scarface reboot, are you going to think that's tarnished the first one for me?
No. I don't think it will. I mean, the whole thing for me about reboots, if it's justified, then yeah, do it. You know, if the whole point of me for remaking a movie is if you fucked it up the first time, you know, when are they going to get Fantastic Four right? You know, there's going to probably be another 17 Fantastic Four movies before they actually get it right. You know, and for me, that movie deserves a reboot. You know, Scarface? No. Why would you need to reboot it? Now, on the other hand, you know, I genuinely really enjoy Michael B. Jordan. You know, and as I said there, I think, you know, I as you know yourself, Black Panther's in the top five Marvel movies for me. And I think his performance as Killmonger is probably one of the mitigating factors in my thinking behind that. Seeing him do that, but if they go down the whole route of, there's two things that I don't want to see, right? Number one, I don't want to see it be a shot for shot kind of remake and Michael B. Jordan with a stupid Cuban accent. You know, number two, which I fucking hope they don't go down the route of, and that is to kind of turn it into kind of some, you know, hood type of movie and totally go down that whole kind of stereotypical kind of, you know, Black America gangster kind of thing. You know, that's
Thinking back now to Black Panther and the layers and the depth of his character there, and the story very much saying, you know, we are oppressed people, let's rise up, etc. It won't surprise me if they go down that route. But he needs to be an immigrant. The whole Scarface is an immigrant that comes to this country to make it big and ends up suffering. That's Scarface for me. So,
I know, but the whole political climate in America now, you know that the angle that they're going to go down, you know, with the race relations that are in America, and there's a lot of people who are Americans that just don't feel like Americans.
Absolutely. I think if you give them a...
Deep. You get the deepness there?
I get the deepness. It's very deep.
I'm going to start listening to Gangster's Paradise when I get into the house.
Look, you can listen to Coolio as much as you want. You can listen to Gangster's Paradise as much as you want. But we all know "See You When You Get There" is actually his phrase.
Well,
when you get there.
Let's put it like this. And I will finish on this in Scarface.
Yeah.
On Scarface, if you want to see a good hood movie, just watch Boys in the Hood.
Yeah.
That's it.
For me, in terms of remakes, if you want to watch the original, watch the original. If you want to watch the 1932 version of Scarface, because there was one and you're that appalled by the reboot, go and watch that. If you don't want to watch this reboot, if you think, no, I don't want one, then don't fucking watch it. Having said that, I'm the biggest hypocrite in the world, and I'm thinking of one that we need to discuss, because I'm going to say two words to you. I'm going to say this to you. We've just said that, absolutely, there's no need for it. If you want to watch the original, watch the original. The second one doesn't diminish the first one. I want an episode on the new version of Point Break against the original, and we're going to put that one to bed. What do you think?
Listen, 100%. I have a massive hard-on for Patrick Swayze. Oh. any movie that Swayze's in, you know. I tried to get my 10-year-old son to watch Roadhouse, and my missus was not having it at all.
I wonder why.
Listen, Patrick Swayze was just kung fu kicking and chopping people in the throats and shit.
Get Donnie Darko on. You can see him with his kiddie pond dungeon.
Listen. It annoys me. Seeing Donnie Darko is a great movie. Obviously, it's one of your favorite movies, if not your favorite movie.
Top three.
Yeah.
The best.
I don't like it when my heroes are cast in some kind of weird light, you know. So I'm not going to spoil it for anybody, but you know, Patrick is not the greatest character in Donnie Darko, as well as Kurt Russell in Guardians of the Galaxy 2. I'm sorry, I'm not having Kurt Russell as a bad guy that I can't root for. No, I'm not having it. I'm simply not having it.
You know what? We'll do one on villains one day as well. But you, Ego in Guardians of the Galaxy 2, I was there watching that, and I thought for a bit, I'm watching that, and I think, you know what? This is, I know it was before that time, but think, you know, use it as an example now. I was feeling the same way about him as I do a Thanos and a Killmonger. This is a guy with layers. He's got a point to an extent. You know, he wants to make a world. He wants to find his son. He wants to find love. Okay. And then the spoiler, which we're not going to say in case you haven't seen Guardians of the Galaxy 2, greetings to everybody living on Mars. But if that hadn't have happened the way it did, I'd have had more sympathy for him. But there was no sympathy there. But anyway, that's the thing. That's nearly it for the news, though. I'll tell you what, though, Cormac. I'm feeling a little thirsty. I'm thirsty for some Nicolas Cage news. So this is a new feature of ours. Every time we feel necessary, we're going to take a...
Feature?
this is a new feature. We're going to take a jaunt into Nicolas Cage Corner. We're going to learn what the big man's been about this week. I think it's only right that we fill you in with everything's happening with our favourite Hollywood lunatic. What you got for us?
Well, have you watched Tiger Man?
I haven't. I've been told to, and I haven't.
Okay, well, I'll break Tiger Man down for you. I'm not gonna spoil it. I'm not gonna say anything. So,
okay.
Basically, Joe Exotic is one of the biggest characters with regards to tiger breeding within the United States. Or
is he the blonde-haired, mulleted guy that I'm seeing pictures of him everywhere? Crazy That's Hawaiian shirt. Yep.
Yeah,
okay.
That's him, yeah, the sexual Tyrannosaurus that is Joe Exotic. So basically it gives you through the trials and tribulations of a year, I think it's 5 years in the life of Joe Exotic, and his hatred for some people, mainly Carol Baskin.
Carol Baskin.
Yeah. Recently in the news, Nicolas Cage has signed on to play Joe Exotic in a movie.
Okay,
so
you had my interest.
Yeah. So to explain Joe Exotic is a guy who walks around with a guy who hugs tigers, a guy who has multiple husbands at any one time, you know, suspected insurance fraudster, suspected of hiring a hitman to kill someone. It's an exciting life that he leads, and I think obviously Nicolas Cage is an exciting man, but I have an issue with Nicolas Cage, right?
That's going to be the name of your autobiography.
I have an issue.
I have an issue with Nicolas Cage.
Do you remember that episode of Father Ted, the Christmas episode? And now, the liars, when he gets his trophy. So, Nicolas Cage, for me, Nicolas Cage when I was growing up. You know, it was Raised in Arizona, Wild at Heart. Nicolas Cage was that actor that you go to for an unbelievable performance. You know, Leaving Las Vegas. You know, there were so many great movies that he was in. And then there was a turn. You know, there was a turn in Nicolas Cage's career, and it happened probably around maybe just into the 2000s. Where
yeah, I was just going to say 95 to 2000, 2002 was probably prime Nicolas Cage. I mean, for me, Face Off, Con Air, The Rock, they are some of the best films. And then you've got Adaptation, Leaving Las Vegas, Bringing Out Your Dead. You know, the guy's an absolute tornado of charisma and lunacy. But then you've got this. So go on. So from about 2002.
My whole thing is, like, there was a turn. There was a turn at some point, and it was around that 2002-2003 where he just started taking roles in movies just for money. You know, as all you can see. You know, he did Bad Lieutenant, which is a great movie, but it kind of played on his eccentricities of being, you know, not the sanest person in the asylum. And, you know, it just seems to me that he's created this kind of aura of manic kind of life. And, you know, we've all seen the pictures of him in your man. I can't even remember where the band he was from. Was it... what was his name? I can't remember his name. He's some rock star. He was in Tommy Lee's band. What's Tommy Lee's band called? Motley Crue.
Motley Crue.
And then he was outside. Yeah, he was outside some fucking casino in Las Vegas, and, you know, some reporter said something, and then, you know, the two of them were dressing, you know, snakeskin jackets and glasses, and they were hammered, And it's, and then, you know, there's stories of him and Charlie Sheen being on a plane, and, you know, Nicolas Cage taking the microphone and saying that the plane's going down. You know, there's stories of him buying an octopus to help him to act. You know, there's stories...
Who hasn't bought an octopus to help him with danger?
But where did this come from? Why did this happen? You know, I genuinely don't understand where this came from. You know, was he hard up for money? You know, yes, he does seem to like the extravagant lifestyle. You know, he does like to go out and buy things, but, you know...
What was the story I heard that he owed Mongolia, like a jewel-encrusted dinosaur skull or something? Do you not remember this?
I remember something about him buying a dinosaur skull, and it was fake, and he spent about... He spent an awful lot of money on a skull, and it was a fake, so maybe that's what it is, I don't know.
Something like that. I heard recently that he were in a bit of money trouble or whatever, and he ended up having to give an artifact back to some Mongolian or something. I don't know, maybe it's just, you look at all these actors, and maybe because they're expected to be wild and crazy and zany, that he's just going off and living his life how everyone expects him to. Maybe he's just this mental crazy guy who's been absorbed in his work. I don't know, but the guy's an absolute force of nature. So your news this week, so he's actually going to be playing him in what, a TV show, film, Joe Exotic?
It seems like it's going to be a film, but who knows what kind of a film it's going to be, you know, with Nicolas Cage, and that's where this kind of leads into. You know, it's got a lot of traction of him playing Joe Exotic, just simply because, obviously, you know, Tiger King has been pretty big in the lexicon lately. But, you know, what kind of movie are we actually going to get out of it? Are we going to get a good budgeted movie? Are we going to get a fucking Nicolas Cage movie? Are we going to get Wild at Heart, or are we going to get The Wicker Man? You know, what are we going to get?
I've never seen Tiger King. I've seen, don't get me wrong, I've seen bits of it. I've seen the trailer on Netflix. It's just one of those things I haven't got around to watching. If you're going to make
it's worth watching. It is worth watching. It genuinely is one of the very few documentaries that have made me feel really uncomfortable.
Okay.
In a good way, and it's kind of because you just want to keep watching it. But there's a couple of scenes in it that are just fucking insane, you know.
We've obviously been talking about the news this week. We're going to be revisiting Nicolas Cage Corner. Whenever Nick pops his head up and decides to do something worthy of our analysis, I think that analysis very well, very appropriate analysis of what's going on with Nicolas Cage. But we're going to come back to him because we love him to bits and we want to know what's going on in his life. So he always deserves that attention. Now, so have you been watching much in this lockdown? Have you been watching many films?
Movies, not so much. TV shows, yeah.
Go on, what have you been watching?
Obviously watched Tiger King, something I've been recently watching though. Future Man, have you seen it?
No, what's that?
It's produced by Seth Rogen. Your man Hutchinson or Hutcherson from the Hunger Games is in it. Basically kind of like a loner, kind of nerdy kind of guy, constantly plays this one game, this multiplayer game online, and he can't beat it, and then suddenly he beats it, and then it's actually a game that's been sent back in time by freedom fighters in the future. And the first person to beat it is the chosen one, and they have to try and stop the apocalypse in some way. It sounds nuts, but it's not,
it does,
actually,
yes.
It's not got that big of a budget, and it's very much a comedy as well. It touches on a lot of 80s things. It touches on Haley Joel Osment's in it. He's one of the main characters in the second season. And he's very good at it.
Did you watch The Boys on Amazon?
Yes, that superhero one, yeah.
Yeah. Was it Haley Joel Osment who was in that? I'm sure he was in that for a couple of episodes. Was it The Boys?
I can't remember. No. A couple of them kind of merged into one for me. Like there was the Doom Patrol and The Boys, and then there was that Umbrella Academy.
Umbrella Academy is fantastic. That's probably the best one. It's very good.
Yeah.
I watched, have you ever heard of 11-22-63 with James Franco?
11-22-63. Oh, yes. Is that JFK one?
Yeah, about a man who finds a way to go back in time to the 1960s and starts looking into, because obviously with everything that you know, you can plan on trying to change the past. But short miniseries, I think it's about 8 or 10 episodes, and I thought that was really, I didn't think I'd enjoy it, to be honest. I watched for the first time the other day Hunt for Red October.
Awesome.
The most Scottish Russian commander who's ever lived, with Sean Connery. Hello, my name is Rasmus Marco, captain of... Oh, shut up, Sean. And then the other day...
That was a really good accent.
It was Russian. It was from Moscow. And the... I'm just thinking about... Anyway, if you like your stand-up comedy, go and look for a bit from Sean Connery with Stuart Francis. He does a great bit on Sean Connery. Anyway, I watched... I was feeling pretty dirty the other day, and I decided to put on Saw, because I haven't seen that in a while.
I'm glad you said Saw there.
I was feeling a bit dirty the other day.
I was feeling a wee bit dirty there today.
Pounders 7. No, I watched Saw, and then I just thought, fuck it, we're on a
roll. They made an Ass Pounder 7?
Yeah, you got to see the first 6, or you won't have a clue what's going on. But then I just decided to watch. So on Friday, I watched every single Saw film one after the other. And it was horrific. Absolutely horrific experience. Yeah. I've never actually watched them all one after the other. But don't get me wrong, they get absolutely terrible as they go along. As the money goes down, their films get worse and worse. But I felt like watching something a bit sick and violent. And I watched all 4 Lethal Weapons as well.
Can I tell you a story about Saw?
This is a personal story.
This is not.
Well, this I once got kidnapped by a serial killer, and he made me cook off.
So, I think it was the second one, and
you saw something about.
Yeah, why?
I'm just asking if you did Seesaw too.
Seesaw.
Yeah. Did you Seesaw?
Shut up! That is an awful joke. Right, so at the time I was going out with someone, and she was a bit of a horror fan, and I always loved the drink. You know this. I loved the drink. She liked the old marijuana. She loved the old marijuana cigarettes.
The old Mary Jane.
The old Mary Jane. So I decided that was the right time to rekindle my smoking of a joint just before I went into Seesaw 2. And I went in, and I think Saw 2 is the one where the girl's head is in like a cage of spikes or something. And halfway through the movie, I think it was just after the spike thing, I closed my eyes, and I kept my eyes closed for the rest of the movie.
Jesus. Yeah, I don't blame you, to be honest.
I was completely and utterly freaked out.
Was it the mask that had the spikes on the inside?
Yes.
See, I've just watched them all. And if you don't set the timer off, it clapped. Yeah, okay, yes. Yeah. I don't blame you.
Awful. It was an awful experience, Paul. An awful experience. An experience that I don't want to do again. And I think that is probably... That's the whole kind of reason why I don't really like watching horror movies. After that experience.
Do you know they're doing another one?
Why?
Hang on. You're not going to believe this. Okay. So there was Saw 1 to 6. Then there was 3D, which was like... blood flying at the camera, and back in those 4 years when 3D was a thing. Wait, and then
whoa. They made 7 Saw movies?
No. Then they made another one. So I sat and watched 8 of them on Friday.
Whoa. They made 8 Saw movies?
Yeah, they did 1 to 6, 7, which was 3D, or the final chapter, which it wasn't. Then they made Jigsaw, which came out a couple of years back, which was supposed to reset it all, but it didn't. But anyway. And then recently it's been announced that they were making one called Spiral, : from the Book of Saw.
Is colon in it?
Colon. It's called Spiral, colon. Spiral, colon. Book of Saw. It's Chris Rock has written this film. hang on. Chris Rock is starring in this film. And do you know who else is in this? Samuel Jackson.
Fuck off.
And apparently it's... do you know what? The reason I watched them is because the thing that I'm not big on torture porn and stuff like that. I can take horrors, give them or leave them. I appreciated the story in them, that you can write a film 10 years later. And if you watch them one after the other...
Are you trying to tell me that there's a legitimate fucking story thread arc the whole way through the Saw movies? Is that what you're fucking trying to say to me?
Yes, there is, and I will die on that bridge.
You're hypnotized. You're hypnotized. You've been taking acid, and you fucking watched the Saw movies, and now you're like Timothy Leary just after his first drop of acid, and you're mental.
Who the fuck is Timothy Leary?
The guy who basically created LSD.
Oh, okay. Sorry, Cheech Marin. I'm not clued upon all my drug, whatever. So who we got in this in Spiral? A bunch of people you don't know. Samuel Jackson, Chris Rock. The story's by Chris Rock, apparently. He's playing Detective Zeke Banks. Anyway, no, so there's another Saw film coming up, so that's what I've been doing myself. As you can tell, I am single, and I live with
women. Ready to mingle, ladies!
reason I'm asking that is because I've obviously been spending a lot of time on Twitter as well. I've been bored out of my skull, and there's one thing I wanted to pick up, and I'm going to do this every episode with you. Have you seen the 30-day film challenge that's been flying around?
No.
I noticed it because James Gunn has been doing it, and he's been picking up on that. We're allowed to like James Gunn again now because he made a joke 12 years ago. 30-day film challenge.
Son of a bitch.
You prick, how dare you have a sense of humor nobody else appreciates.
You made a joke 20 years ago and now everybody's offended? Oh, I'm offended.
How did he not know he was becoming a huge megastar director? How did he not know? Why do you not watch every single... You know what? We're going to have to monitor these podcasts, because as soon as I become famous in 20 years' time, somebody's going to go back and go, you slagged Saw off, you prick. The 30-day film challenge has been made...
Bastards!
They both sound Irish. The 30-day film challenge. It's been made by I'm going to give them credit, because at It's Raining Han and at Hostile_0 and at Cries. Yeah, okay. Well done, guys and girls. So right. The idea is over 30 days, you either watch or talk about a film from a particular category. So we're going to go from day one. Each episode, we're just going to have a bit of a chat about each one of those and give you a bit more insight into our whatever the fuck you want to call it. Day one, the first film you remember watching. Let's say at the cinema, because you've probably seen plenty of films. What's your first memory of going to the cinema? What's one of the first films you saw at the cinema?
I actually remember the first movie that I saw in the cinema. I actually remember the first three movies I saw in the cinema. First one was
Aspounders 1, 2, and 3. It was who, sorry?
Santa Claus the movie.
Okay.
Dudley Moore. John Lithgow. Yeah. Second one was Short Circuit 2.
Of course.
And the third one was He-Man Masters of the Universe.
That is a fantastic film. I love that film. Anyway, people listening to this is going to be like, so they've done a special on Hudson Hawk and they're going to do one on Point Break and Masters of the Universe.
Well, you see, the whole thing about movie, like, obviously, I'm from a small town in Tyrone in Ireland, right? And, you know, you're obviously from Leeds, just outside of Leeds. I don't know what it was like in England back in the late 80s, early 90s, but it was awful fucking hard to get a movie that, you know, into the cinema. And if it was released in America in like 86 and it was released in Oma in 89, yeah. You know, so it was kind of tough. But my first movie experience was Santa Claus the movie with Dudley Moore. And I still fucking love it. And every single time I see it at Christmas time, when that little girl gives that orphan kid the plate of food with the big fucking Coca-Cola, that's amazing. That's my take. I love that tin of Coke. That tin of Coke gets me every time.
I was thinking on this today, and I'm trying to think back, and you know what? I can remember going to see Jungle Book. Now, obviously, it came out, what, late 60s, wasn't it, when it was first made? So I don't think I went the first time it was on. But I remember going to this cinema in Dewsbury in West Yorkshire, home of Karen Matthews.
Killers
and abductors. But the cinema in the centre of Dewsbury, and for all you thousands of listeners who come from Dewsbury, it was just down the road from where the Woolworths was and the bank, and you're just going around and you go around the corner. Dewsbury's you've never been to Dewsbury, have you, Cormac? Dewsbury's one of those towns.
Happy to Dewsbury.
What, we drove through it once?
Yeah, you drove me there.
Oh, right, okay. Did I?
Yeah,
we went all the cold ice. That wasn't Dewsbury, that was Murfield.
No. We drove through Dewsbury.
Oh, we probably did. Anyway, Dewsbury is the type of town that it's McDonald's closed because it wasn't doing enough business. That's the type of town Dewsbury is. So there was a cinema in there, and you had to walk up this big walkway. And I remember my mum had got us tickets to go see Jungle Book. And I must have been 6, 7, something like that. And I remember peering through one of the doors and Batman was on. And I can just remember in my head, it was the balcony scene in the arts, in the art gallery, where he brings Vicky Vale up and flies through the thing. And I just remember at that point, I'm like, I've got to see that movie. Fuck Jungle Book. I want
to
see
Batman. Did you not just turn around to your mother and go, what the fuck are you bringing me to Jungle Book for?
Talking that fucking bears. Stand on
the balcony in there? What the fuck am I in a movie
slap
for?
Around the face.
Fuck sick.
Is this what you're spending my child maintenance on?
Kim Basinger's boobs.
So then Batman was my off school sick video. Then we always used to go to Rich Video Shop, which was Blockbuster before it got taken over, and Batman was my, so that was one of them. And the other one I remember
centre of Leeds, the ABC cinema. Can't remember where it was, down the bottom end. If you just say that to people, down the bottom end of Leeds, everyone's like, oh, okay. And we went to see Back to the Future 2. So it must have been around awesome. The same time, 89. And it was me, my dad, and someone else. And we went. And I remember going to see Back to the Future 2. Obviously enjoying it. It's Back to the Future. And we came out and my dad had double parked afterwards. And he had a parking ticket on his car. And he was fucking livid. He was, you know, imagine being a dad now like you. And you take your kids to see a kids film. A film you're probably not that bothered about. I can't.
I'll take my kids to the cinema, the cunt.
You are.
I'll take my fucking cunty kids to the cinema. Where's your lock money in them?
You lock them in a cage in the garden and feed them with a catapult.
So, and I just remember us coming out afterwards, and we were just sat there looking at my dad. He's got this parking ticket, and he's obviously paid for like 2 hours parking the tight get. And that's one of my other. And I'm trying to think further back than that. And I remember going to see Turner and Hooch as well, but I didn't have a clue what were going on with it. But no, they're some of the first films that I remember seeing. What was your? Did you ever have a off school sick film? Did you ever have something that every time you're off from school as a kid, you used to go straight to?
I was a weird kid growing up. Like I watched an awful lot of movies. I watched an awful lot of movies when I was younger. You know, me and my brother were given a lot of free rein when we were younger. One of my favorite movies when I was a kid was Cobra. I watched Cobra when I was about 5 or 6.
I can imagine you and Ronan going into the local video shop, stood on each other's shoulders in a big trench coat. Hello, my dear shopkeeper. I'm here to rent Cobra.
I'll tell you something weird, because where we used to live in Oma, it was called Castleview. And there was a video shop at the bottom of the hill, and it was called Mulletmore Video. And we used to go in there, and I fucking remember to the day I die, there was a guy called Brian used to own it, and he was so deadly. God rest him, he's dead now. But he was so brilliant, and he used to give me and Ronan like the movies that we shouldn't have been watching. You know, he was a young guy, and literally me and Ronan would have went in on a Friday after school and just stood in there and looked at the covers of videos, and then brought mum down later on, and we would get two movies out. It was only like fucking £1 or £1.50 a night. And then we'd go back down on the Saturday night with the movies that we'd watched, and we'd get two more, and then we'd go back down on the Sunday night and get two more. And it got to the point where, you know, Brian liked this because we just kept spending money. But we rented Big Trouble in Little China so many times, he gave us the fucking video. That's how bad it got. He gave us the fucking video.
He just realized it's not worth his money having to deal with it anymore. It just gives you the fucking Did he ask for, like, did you swap him like a £10 note for this film or something? Or did he just
never? Like, literally, we probably had gotten it out for about the 20th time, and we just walked up to the counter and we handed it over to him, and he handed it to us in a plastic bag and was just like, Don't worry about it. I've got another copy. And we were like, And like, funny enough, we still have the VHS copy down in the house, Noma. Like, we still have it. But the Big Trouble in Little China's it's faded off it, but we still have the Mulletmore video.
You two were running home like Charlie Bucket from just finding his golden ticket in Willy Wonka, weren't you? You two just running down the road. Run home, Cormac, run as fast as you can.
Some of the shit that we watched when we were younger, like, we were one of the first people to get Sky in Oma in 91. And it had the Vox channel.
Vox, yeah.
Oh yeah. If you're 40 and you had Sky in the 90s, you'll remember Vox.
Whatever happened to that person that was in that movie 30 years ago? Who was that guy who was in that thing? Do you ever remember that bloke who was in that thing? Does that ever come back to you? Well, Cormac of the Cormaniacs.
Cormaniacs, yes.
You can't say that after a few whiskies. The Cormaniacs, the leader of the Cormaniacs, is on a mission to remind us about what happened to that guy that time. And what have you got for us this week?
Well, I would say to you, don't be sexist. It's I've got two people. I've got a guy and I've got a girl. All right.
So, oh, a girl.
Yeah, I've got a guy and a girl.
Oh, a wee lassie.
So, do you remember the 1986 classic Flight of the Navigator?
Who doesn't?
Exactly. Who doesn't?
Well, to be honest, me.
Well,
I remember there was an eyeball on the end of a stick, and that was about it.
Yes, yes. And do you know who was the voice of that eyeball?
Only because I've read it today, but go on.
Pee Wee Herman, Paul Rubens.
Pee Wee Herman, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. I remember the voice. Because
I wouldn't have had a clue if I hadn't read it today, to be honest.
Really? Well, it was one of those movies that, again, we watched when we were younger. And it was the movie that introduced me to the Beach Boys as well. Yeah, I Get Around in it, and they were singing it when he was flying the plane.
Okay.
So it just got me thinking, you know, what the fuck ever happened to that kid? And like, I never seen him in anything. I never, like, how come he just disappeared off the face of the planet? He didn't die. I'll say that now. He didn't die. He's still alive.
Spoiler alert. Hang on. If you're going to tell the man's story. Again, everyone tuning in for a juicy dead kid story.
So that's more.
So I've got no Morpheus news and no dead children. Unsubscribe. Negative review. 1 star.
So his name was Joey Cramer. He has a longer name, but I'm not going to fucking say it because it's just stupid. His name's probably Joey Cramer. That's
probably Joseph.
It was like Delaharis or something like that there, like, but whatever. It's just hot. It was Joey Cramer's his fucking Hollywood name, so we'll stick with that. Yeah, so yeah. Let's talk a little bit about Flight of the Navigator. You know, so a young boy is basically kidnapped by aliens, and he is brought to the alien planet for tests. And then his head's filled with star charts. And then Max, who's the alien that's inside the craft, crashes his craft and loses all his star charts. So he has to take young David back again so that he can download all the star charts that's inside his head. Another person that I forgot was in this movie, Sarah Jessica Parker.
Really?
Yeah, no, crazily enough.
I haven't watched this film since the 80s, so you're cracking an egg of knowledge on me right now, so sure. Go on.
But like, crazily enough, there's a link to the other person that I didn't realize until I started doing this, and it makes it out as if I planned it, but it really wasn't. It was just happened. So Joey Cramer, Flight of the Navigator was his only movie. That was
really?
It. He wasn't really in anything else. Okay. Made a few TV show appearances and stuff like that there. So he returned to Canada in the early 90s. That's where he was from. He, respectably, worked normal jobs. 2008, he was prosecuted for careless storage of a gun. Whatever that means.
Okay. In Canada, that could mean quite a lot of things, to be honest.
Yeah, in Canada, he had it up a moose's hole or whatever. 2009, trafficking drugs. That's a 6-month prison sentence that he got there. 2010, 2011, threatening behavior with a weapon. He got 30 days for that. Also, he was forging checks. He'd done some forging checks, of course. Everybody does that.
We've all been
there. Then in 2016, he was arrested in connection with a bank robbery in Nova Scotia. He pleaded guilty and he served 2 years.
Okay.
Joey Cramer.
Wow. I mean, it's not the worst child actor story I've ever heard, but it's not the best either.
No. Yeah, yeah. Well, what I want to do in future, though, I want to give some redemption stories. I want to give some nice... Yeah, I'm going to give some redemption stories, but here's the connection, okay? Here's the connection.
Right.
So, my second person is Jennifer Grey.
Yeah, baby.
So, baby, Jennifer Grey, she was Ferris's sister in yep. Bueller. She was in the Cotton Club. Around 85, 86, 87... You know, Jennifer was probably one of the hottest female actresses on the planet. You know, in the space of 3 years, she had Bueller and Dirty Dancing. Dirty Dancing came out in 87. And then nothing really after that. You know, she kind of rescinded into the wilderness, and you know, nothing really from that afterwards.
You know why that is, though, don't you?
Well, this is what I'm going to get into.
Okay.
So in 1987, her and Matthew Broderick kept their romance away from Hollywood. They never really explained why. It was after Bueller as well, so you know. Really didn't mean fuck all. Maybe it was because Dirty Dancing was coming out, and you know, she didn't want anybody thinking that she wanted to fuck anybody else but Patrick Swayze. But her and Matthew Broderick were over in my neck of the woods, just over the border from Tyrone in Enniskillen. And one fateful night in 1987, Matthew Broderick was driving a car and he went over to the wrong side of the road and crashed into a car and killed two people. He was fined $170.
Okay.
And he was
it's obviously a serious thing. We're not going to take the piss out of two people who've passed away, obviously.
Yeah,
but was there any? It wasn't obviously if it wasn't drunk or anything. Was it just I was driving on the wrong side of the road? Sorry about that kind of thing. Or...
There was never really any explanation as to what happened. Jennifer Grey said that one second they were in the car listening to music, the next her life changed forever. So after that, she pulled out of all the promotion work for Dirty Dancing. She didn't, you know, think it was right that two people had died, and you know, she was going to go out and promote Dirty Dancing. And then that was kind of it for her. You know, she turned away from the spotlight, turned away from movies. She was in a few things, and then in 2010, she was in the American version of Strictly Come Dancing. And you know, she kind of, do you know,
I remember from that Dancing with the Stars? Yeah, she won that 20 something. Yeah, she won. I mean, that's a bit of an odd tournament to go into. You're going to a competition called Dancing with the Stars and you're known as being in Dirty Dancing. That's pretty high bar that you've set yourself. But no, she went and won that one. But what? So who's she married to now? Are you asking me that?
It's the guy from Avengers, cool. That age, the agent guy. What's his name? Coulson? Agent Coulson?
Clark Gregg?
That's him.
Yeah. Well, I didn't know that.
Yeah.
I know all I remember about Jennifer Grey, like you said, I can't remember anything from her. I remember she had the nose job done because she wanted to, you know, and then apparently she had another one to fix something that went wrong with the first one. And then after that, no bugger knew her, no bugger could recognize her. I've got a picture here on IMDb, I wouldn't recognize her if I passed her on the street.
I just don't understand why some women do that to themselves. You know,
Jennifer, men. She was sexist.
She was okay, sorry. She was like a very, very, she was a very, very beautiful woman. And,
yeah,
you know,
I do this, but, you know, yeah, it's, I don't know, maybe you think you're going to be on a bunch of, but then again, if you're going to be in Dirty Dancing and you're thinking it's because you're opposite Patrick Swayze.
You got to look good to fuck the Swayze.
Do you know the reason why my mom said she never fancied Patrick Swayze when I were a kid? She never fancied
because
it.
Because he wouldn't fuck her?
Probably, but he was also a smoker. And she said he's a smoker. He's dirty. But, no, so we've got...
smoking fucking hot.
You'd have his babies, wouldn't you?
You're fucking right.
I'd strangle a dolphin to fuck Swayze.
Cormac Swayze. I think that's a great name.
So we've got Joey Cramer, who was in The Flight of Navigator, pretty bad life. He was in a couple of films, and then it's just been down on his luck ever since. Then we've got Jennifer Grey, so she was in Dancing with the Stars, and then not a lot else afterwards.
That was it. And then she kind of married into money and got the Avengers stuff. That was it.
Yeah. Well, no, he was killed off in the first Avengers, so he wouldn't have been getting those checks. He's on Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. money. He's on 30 grand an episode or whatever it is.
That's still good.
Yeah,
that's,
I'll be honest, yeah.
I'll buy you a few bottles of wine. Like.
Okay, quiz time.
quiz time, Cormac. I'm going to quiz you. You came to me last time with budgets and how much films took from the 80s and how much they made against their production costs and things like that. So it's made me think I want to come and test you. So we're going to test each other. I'm going to ask you two questions. Well, they've all got multiple answers, but you'll get the gist. Play along at home. See if you know any of these. If you've got any ideas for a few quiz topics, at Pod Movie Chef. Obviously, we want to hear from our fans all around the globe. So
that one guy who's in Australia.
Hello.
He accidentally listened to the podcast.
He clicked on Movie Chef. I thought it was the formula. I thought it was the cricket. I thought it was the cricket lad. Sorry, but I was looking for a recipe on how to make shrimp. Right. What's your movie? Your movie trivia is pretty good. You know shit. You know you're pretty good with this. So I'm alright asking you these. Movie companies. Yep. Movie business, and I've told you beforehand that I'm going to ask you this, but I haven't told you, and I'll say at the end where I got these from for the other one. But so I'm going to name a company from a movie, and you have to tell me which movie that came from. Give it a couple of seconds for people at home if they're having a think, and then see if you can guess. So if I was to say the name of the company, Monsters Inc., that would be from the film
Monsters Inc.
Well done. Okay, so I'm going to go through these. So give us a couple of seconds for people at home, to, if they're listening, to try and answer these. They start fairly easy. I think they get harder, but we'll say you are pretty good. You are my clever little Irish bear. So
there's not many of us.
First one, Cyberdyne Systems. Cyberdyne Systems, which film series is that company from? 1983, 1992 sequel.
Terminator.
It is Terminator, yes. Cyberdyne Systems.
Okay.
Omni Consumer Products.
Omni Consumer. Robocop.
Yep, Robocop. OCP. InGen. What? Say that again.
OCP.
OCP. That's what we chant in the streets. InGen.
InGen.
Yeah.
InGen.
Huge film series. Started around 93. And it's had two sequels plus...
Oh, Jurassic Park.
Jurassic Park, yeah. Quick Stop.
Quick Stop.
This is the name of a shop. Black and white film.
Oh, Clerks.
Clerks, yep. Okay, they're getting a bit harder now. I'm gonna keep giving you clues. I hope you don't mind. Bushwood Country Club. The Bushwood Country Club.
Bushwood.
It has a golf course.
Is it Caddyshack?
It is Caddyshack, yep.
Yeah.
McDowell's.
Oh, Coming to America.
Of course it is, yep. The Paper Street Soap Company.
Fight Club.
Yeah, didn't even have a chance to finish my drink there. Right, they're getting hard now. Lacuna Inc. L-A-C-U-N-A Inc.
Lacuna Inc.
Jim Carrey film.
Lacuna Inc. Eternal Sunshine?
It is Eternal Sunshine.
Yeah. I was listening to, I'll be honest with you, it was a fucking toss-up. It was either going to be Truman Show or...
Truman Show, yeah. Macmillan Toys.
Millen Toys.
Macmillan Toys. 80s film.
Right.
Set in New York.
It's either going to be too... Well, Big...
Yes, it is Big. Well done.
It was either going to be Toys or Big. And as soon as you said 80s and New York, that was it.
Universal Exports.
Whoa.
Multiple films.
Universal Exports?
Yeah, we're talking 60s onwards.
Blah. Universal Exports? I have no idea.
That is the cover name for MI6 in the James Bond films originally.
They had offices with the Science Universe on there. You got one for me?
You cheeky bastard. Want a company name? I got a company name. Do you want a company name?
No, give us what have you got there? You told me you had one for me.
I have six for you. I have six. I have a little quiz. So about a year ago when we first started doing this, or thinking about doing this podcast.
Yeah, we're not too light on our feet when it comes to following through with ideas.
So we suffered through Hercules in New York.
We did. We hadn't even done an episode on that. We just watched it.
I know, and I put myself under so much pressure to fucking watch that stupid shit as well.
Like, I'm still gonna be watching that again.
I bought the fucking thing on Amazon. It's still there. $7.99 it cost me on fucking Amazon. But you know the worst thing is I needed to buy the fucking version with Arnold Schwarzenegger's voice in it. So that's why it cost me $7.99. And then I fucking found out that it was free on YouTube.
I found it for a quid in the charity shop.
It's still raw. It's still raw. So the whole point, I did this little quiz back then because Arnold was called Arnold Strong in the credits to Hercules in New York. So it got me thinking as to names of actors and actresses before they changed them when they entered into the realm of Hollywood. So, first one, you should get this. Everybody knows this one. Number one.
Michael Caine.
Fuck off.
Is it? Maurice McElroy.
It's Maurice McElroy. Fuck off. I started with the easy one. Oh, fuck.
Everyone knows Michael Caine. Come on. Right. Maurice McElroy. McElroy, whatever he's called. Michael Caine.
All right, you got one.
And if you're in Australia talking about your drugs, Michael Caine. What have you got? Come on.
Okay. Number two, Krishna Pandit Baji. Krishna Pandit Baji.
You're going to have to give some clues.
He was in my favorite British movie of all time. With Ray Winston.
Oh, Ben Kingsley. Sir Ben Kingsley. Benjamin of the Kingsley. Ben. Yeah. Sir Benjamin. 60 Beast, yeah.
I seen your podcast with Dan last week. I listened to it.
Yeah.
Genuinely don't understand how no one chose Sexy Beast.
I was close in there, but yeah. Sexy Beast should have been in there, to be honest. But
Or. The Long Good Friday.
I'm not saying they're definitive. It's just ones that we've...
Fuck off. Right. Mark Sinclair. He's recent. He's a recent one.
What, recently born? I don't know.
Well, I recently born. Fuck.
Mark Sinclair.
He is in... probably one of the biggest franchises of recent times. He is... let me think. Do you know what? He's in two of the biggest franchises in the last 10 years. Like, and I'm not talking about small. I'm talking about fucking huge franchises.
We're talking what? MCU and...
one of them is MCU.
And the other one, big franchise, last 10 years, you're talking what?
No, I'm not talking big. I'm talking fucking colossal franchises.
Well, Avatar's not a franchise yet.
Not Star Wars either. Not Star Wars either. Think more to do with automotive.
Oh, fuck. I just had it there. Give me a...
in my automobile.
Give us a clue. Tell us the franchise with the fuck cars.
Fast and Furious.
Right. Okay. Mark Sinclair, who's in both of those. Christ on a bike. What is wrong with me today? Go on.
It is Vinny Diesel.
Vinny Diesel was Mark Sinclair. Vincent Mark Diesel. Sinclair. Wow. Okay. Well, they made a good choice there.
Okay. Now, there's a couple here that are really hard to pronounce. Okay, so I'm gonna try this one.
Steve.
Eliana Lydia Vasiluna Marinov.
Ah, I've heard this one. Eliana Vasiluna.
Think of the last one. Eliana Lydia Vasinola Marinov.
I've heard it before. I've heard it recently.
She is in my top three, Paul.
Anne Whittaker.
Whatever age.
Oh, Helen Mirren.
Damn right. Age.
That's it. We don't need any more of that. If Helen Mirren's available, she's getting conned.
Oh, here, I'm not even joking on that. She's a fantastic woman. Okay, so next one. Netta Lee Hirschlang. Netta Lee Hirschlang.
Hirsch. Nah, Jude, give us a clue, come on.
She was in the Star Wars universe.
Not Daisy Ridley.
I can't remember if she went down on someone or someone went down on her in a movie, in a Darren Aronofsky movie. Either or.
Either or, it's worth a watch. That is a 5-star recommendation. Someone went down on her in
a Darren Aronofsky.
Why am I trying to rack my brains of all the fellatio scenes in Darren Aronofsky film? I watched Noah the other day and they were still banging in that. Have you seen Noah?
Is that one with fucking
Noah? Ray Winston, yeah, the big arc and Ray Winston
and Batman.
Oh, I'm a fuck you. Oh, I'm here to be your. Yeah, it was pretty good. It was good. Yeah, no, I don't know who Natalie Hirschlang is. Hirschlang.
Natalie Portman.
Okay, somebody went down on her.
it was either she went down on Mila Kunis in Black Swan.
Kunis went down on her.
All right, okay, there you go.
I'll
be honest with you, it's the only part of the movie that I've ever watched, and I've not really got that much of a recollection of it.
I went to see it with a pain in the ass, and because she really wanted to see it, and I just knew that something was going to happen between them during it. It's like, yeah, not a problem. It's an artistic piece of work. Oh my God, they're in bed.
Damn right. What?
I was going on all the Bound notice boards there. Wasn't as good as Bound, everybody.
Right, last one.
Yep.
Isar Danilovich. Now, he's quite a classical kind of actor. Not classical, I suppose. Not, that's a wrong kind of fucking term. He's an old actor.
Ralph Fiennes. Is it? Not Ray.
What?
Ray Fiennes.
No, not Ray Fiennes. No.
When you take that, it's not Ray, because when you take the first name and you spell it R-L-P-H, R-A-L-P-H, you get Ralph. But anyway, go on. Who have you got?
It's Kirk Douglas.
Give over. God rest his soul.
It's our Daniel Lolovich.
So does that mean Catherine Zeta-Jones's real name is
Daniel Lolovich?
Catherine Zeta-Jones Danilovich. Oh, fair enough. I've got another one for you, dead quick. I've got about 10 of them. I'm going to cut them down here. Right. These are films. I'm going to give you the title after it has been translated by the country I'm going to give you, and then it's translated into English. So foreign films, a lot of the time, there's certain names or there's certain words in the films that don't translate from English into that country of origin, so they make up their own title for that film. These have been translated back into English, and we're going to see if you can get them, okay? So the first one is a Chinese translation. It's a British film. Its title in China was Six Naked Pigs.
Six Naked Pigs?
Yep, a British film, mid-90s. Set in Yorkshire.
Full Monty.
Full Monty. The Full Monty in China was titled Six Naked Pigs.
They took the Hong Kong thing really badly, didn't they?
They really didn't enjoy us giving it back. Right, here's one for you. It's fairly easy. Well, it's a multiple choice. The title was from Denmark, Die Hard, Mega Hard.
It's Die Hard.
Is that your answer?
Yeah.
No, it was Die Hard with a Vengeance. Die Hard 3.
Ah, fuck! So what was Die Hard 2? Die Hard Hard?
Die Harder. Chinese again. I'm not going to do all 10. Son of Devil. Schwarzenegger.
Exorcist?
No, oh, Schwarzenegger film.
Son of... Oh, is Gabriel Byrne in it?
Nope.
All right, well, is that that one, though? Son of Devil. Predator?
Nope.
Son of Devil. Son of Devil. Terminator?
No.
Last action hero?
Junior? Apparently, in China, when the same actor plays the same role in different films, and for some reason, I'm going to double check this, but I think I was quite drunk when I wrote it down. But no, it's true. Schwarzenegger had played a character called Devil. I think it was like from Predator or something, where he played the Devil or Devil someone or other. So the translation for Junior was Son of the Devil, Son of Devil. So it was, yeah. It's Raining Falafel, the title of the Israeli release. Animated feature?
Oh, Cloudy with a Chance?
It is Cloudy with a Chance of Meatballs. I'll give you two more. Japanese translation. I'm drunk and you're a prostitute.
Pretty Woman!
No. Good answer though, 2 points. Nicolas Cage film, we've mentioned it today.
Oh, Leave Las Vegas.
It is. I'm drunk and you're a prostitute. Two tickets for I'm drunk and you're a prostitute, please. And the last one, the Argentinian. I'm not even giving you any clues here. You get 10 seconds. The Argentinian translation of a film. The title translated to Vaseline.
Vaseline?
Vaseline.
Showgirls? Showgirls? Slippery nipples. What's Vaseline? Vaseline. Vaseline. Car.
Do an car. Episode.
Mad Max.
Where the fuck do you get Vaseline from? Mad Max.
You don't look greasy. You don't look greasy in Mad Max. Oh, what the fuck?
70s film. Vaseline.
Vaseline. Vaseline.
What's Vaseline?
It is something that you put in your lips to make them nice and lush.
And what product?
Rocky Horror.
What?
Rocky Horror?
No. What is it? What is the product? What is it?
Petroleum? Petrol? Petroleum?
Petroleum jelly, yeah. And it's... what does it do? What can it be used as a function for?
Oh, grease!
Hey! I can't believe I'm going to say this. Have you ever seen? Oh, come on! Okay, now why is my memory going? Boys Who Did South Park, Matt Stone and Trey Parker, Orgasmo, where the woman was on the bed, and I watched it once, and that picture fills me with dread, and it haunts my dreams. The old woman giving the cute, innocent mom and some sage advice. And she says she still gets work because she's the only one that does DPDA. And when he asks that, what that is, four men come into the room and she says, grease them up, boys. I'm going to leave it at that.
What a nice way to leave it there.
I enjoyed that. Then there were some good quizzes. There were good quiz questions. I think I honestly didn't think you'd get the
things like McDowell's and the more harder ones. You flew through them, and it was Cyberdyne systems that you had a problem with. I think
it was the Cyberdyne was. Everybody thinks Skynet, and it just took me a while for it to click on. But coming to America, probably the easiest one. Easy buns.
Easy buns. And it's got a sequel coming, which will be in the news next episode. So that's pretty much it from us. We're going to do an episode for you in the middle of the week. We're just trying some stuff out, see what works. We're going to look at Point Break, and we're going to look at the reboot. I love Point Break. The first is a masterpiece. Kathleen Bigelow's opus of genius. We got Swayze.
We got Keanu. We got the Red Hot Chili Peppers. Gary Busey.
Laurie Petty.
One of my sexual awakenings of the 90s.
And then we had, I hope she doesn't know about it. And then we're
The 90s
was a long decade.
It was a fucking long decade.
So we're going to look at them too. We're going to look at the two back-to-back against each other. We're going to compare them. We're going to look at why the first one was a masterpiece. We're going to look why the second one was a bag of shit and compare the two. And then the following weekend, we're going to have the third episode bringing you a movie menu from ourselves. I'm going to give the choice to you, Com. Seeing as though I picked, our Twitter users picked the first ones. We've either got, we're going to do an actor. So you can either have Arnold Schwarzenegger or Nicolas Cage. Who's your pick for the movie menu next week?
Okay. Arnie. It's got to be Arnie. We've got Nicolas Cage news. We got to go Arnie.
Well, we'll go over to Nicolas Cage corner regardless. But yeah. So next weekend, we're going to serve you a menu of starters, a fish course, a main course, and our desserts of what our top and most favourable Arnold Schwarzenegger films are. We're going to pay tribute to the Austrian Oak next week. During the week, we're going to have the Point Break versus episode, whatever you want to call it. Anything more you want to add, Com?
No.
No? Well, we're going to head off. And if you've got any thoughts, feedback, suggestions for future episodes at Pod Movie Chef on Twitter. Be sure to follow us, subscribe, like, give us reviews, do whatever the fuck you want to do, but please tell us how.
One Australian man or woman or child or whoever.
Yeah,
make himself known.
Apparently, we have an Australian listener. I don't know if it's somebody who's just got a VPN and has gone through Australia when it's really somebody like one of my mates down the road, or it's somebody who clicked on us, but we're really looking for the MasterChef podcast with John Turode and whoever the fuck it is. So look, if you like, listen to us, if you like us, drop us a message. We'd love to hear from you. We are absolute sycophants who want to be praised. So please get in touch and let us know who you are. Anything more from the Cormaniacs, Cormac?
Nothing, but they love me.
Nothing but they love me. Good night, everybody. Thanks for joining us. Wash your hands.
Round, round, get around. I get around.
Yeah, get around, round, round. I get around.
I get around.